Hello everyone, here is another video on fibro-osseous lesions of bone, and we'll be talking about cherubism. It will be discussed under these headings, followed by MCQs in the end. And for more such videos, please subscribe to our channel and check out our playlist on diseases of the bone and histopathology of various diseases. So getting right into cherubism, the first part of it, let's go over its complex definition. So it tells us that this is an autosomal dominant fibro-osseous lesion of the jaws that stabilizes after the growth period, usually leaving some deformity and malocclusion. Okay, so going over the first part again, this is an autosomal dominant. That means it is a hereditary condition and it is a fibro-osseous lesion. So to understand fibro-osseous lesions, remember our classifications of the bone disorders of the joint face, okay? All the bone disorders of the joint face. They're mainly classified into developmental. They include macrognathia and micrognathia, etc. Then they're classified into benign and malignant lesions like osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma. And then they're classified into fibro-osseous lesions. So fibro-osseous lesions are essentially those where the normal bone structure is replaced by fibrous connective tissue, right? So a hereditary fibro-osseous lesion is cherubism. The other fibro-osseous lesions, they include Paget's disease, fibrous dysplasia, etc. But the hereditary fibro-osseous lesion here is cherubism. Now the second part of it tells us that it stabilizes after growth period. So that means it has tendency for spontaneous remission. So you would see that in the growth period, around 5 years of age, the disease increases, progresses, and by puberty begins to regress. So this disease has a tendency to come and go away. The second thing is, again, it is not a neoplastic lesion, it is a hereditary bone lesion. And the third thing is that it affects the jaws bilaterally, right? So this is the classic example. It mainly affects the jaws, mostly the lower jaws, bilaterally. So it's symmetrical in both the sides. This is why it is also called cherubism. The word cherubism is derived from cherubs. Cherubs were plump-cheeked angels that were seen in Renaissance paintings. So this is why the disease is called cherubism. It was also called familial fibrous dysplasia, but this term is wrong, okay, because it has no relationship to fibrous dysplasia. Genetically, if you go into its etiology, 80% of people show mutations in SH3 domain binding protein 2. Okay, so it has a hereditary basis in 80% of the people. In another 20, it might arise spontaneously. Now, what happens here is that this gene results in the production of an overactive protein, which results in the production of overactive or hyperactive osteoclasts and macrophages, right? So you know osteoclasts are bone resorbing cells, so they cause bone destruction, while macrophages are involved in inflammation, right? So destruction and inflammation. So the overactive protein caused by mutation in the gene causes inflammation and bone destruction, primarily targeted at the jaws. This results radiographically in cyst-like growth patterns. Okay, we'll study this as we progress. The important part here are the clinical features, which is the progression of the disease. See, as I told you in the first slide itself, this disease has a tendency for spontaneous remission. So you would see that at birth the child is normal. But as there is growth occurring, within 14 months to 3 years of age, the disease has an onset. So here you would see symptoms like symmetrical enlargement of the jaws at 3 years. Now by the time the child is 5 to 7 years, there is rapid progression. Okay, and this is where you see the full blown lesions. But around this age, it begins to slow down. Right, so it begins to slow down, and by 12 to 15 years of age, the growth of it stops. By puberty, it begins to regress, right? So up to the third decade of life, there is continued remodeling in the jaws, and most of the people that you would see in that age group, they appear to be normal. Another important thing here is that cherubism is a very rare disease. Okay, it's very rarely seen. It was first described in 1933 only. Right, so not many cases also to study. Now, there are varying degrees of involvement and severity, of course. And the first and primary symptom is bilateral symmetric expansion of the jaws, particularly the mandible greater than maxilla. In the mandible, the most common sites of involvement are the angle, then the ascending ramus, and usually the condyles are spared, right? So I hope you're understanding. This is the angle, ascending ramus, and the condyles are usually spared. In the maxilla, you would see involvement in the maxillary tuberosity. And sometimes it would lead to an inverted V-shaped palatal arch. Some deformities are so grotesque that they can lead to respiratory obstruction as well as impairment in vision and hearing. Okay, some growths in the jaw. The first symptom that you've seen is painless bilateral symmetric expansion of the jaws. Okay, so the second thing that you would see here is something called the eyes upturned to heaven appearance. So if you look at this diagram, you see that the person appears to be looking upward. Why this happens is because of the involvement of the inferior and the lateral orbital nerves, right? This causes the eyeball to tilt upward and retract the lower lid. Right, so the eyeball turns upwards, retracting the lower lid, causing a rim of the sclera to be visible. So because of the visibility of this rim of the sclera, the eyes appear to be turned towards heaven. Right, so this is a eyes upturned to heaven appearance. The third thing you see is enlargement of cervical lymph nodes, mostly the submandibular lymph nodes. And this contributes to fullness of the face. If you look at the grading, first of all, it is associated with certain syndromes, and one of them is Noonan syndrome. And if you look at the grading, main three grades include if this is the mandible, then the first grade involves involvement of both the mandibular ascending rami. The second grade involves maxillary tuberosities as well as the rami. And the third grade involves the entire maxilla in the mandible except the coronoid and the condyle. Remember that condyles were usually less affected. So in the dental alterations, this is quite interesting. Okay, you have early exfoliation of deciduous teeth and impaction of displacement of the teeth. So look at this diagram carefully, right? You see that these teeth appear to be displaced, and they appear to be displaced into radiolucencies, right? You see multiple cystic radiolucencies, and the teeth they seem to be present in this, and this is called the floating tooth appearance. The second thing is that it causes agenesis of certain permanent teeth, especially the second and third molars. You have already studied that in maxilla it might lead to an inverted V palate. And the fourth thing is all of these can lead to malocclusion, problems in phonation, and swallowing. Okay, so remember the floating tooth syndrome, where the teeth seem to float in the radiolucent areas. Okay, so now if you look at the chest of the radiographic features, the classic thing about cherubism, how you identify is the presence of multilocular cystic radiolucencies, and which are bilateral, which is present on both the sides. So if you remember when I was talking about the etiology of the disease, I told you activity of osteoclasts and macrophages leads to inflammation and bone destruction, and that is seen as a cystic appearance in the jaws. So here you see multiple cystic radiolucencies. We have already studied about the floating tooth syndrome. As the disease begins to regress into adulthood, there is re-ossification, patchy sclerosis, which might lead to a ground glass appearance. Additional findings include adjacent tooth root resorption, thinning and perforation of the cortical plates. Histopathologically, it is not diagnostic. It is very similar to giant cell granuloma. Here again, you have a fibrovascular connective tissue. in which dispersed are many multinucleated giant cells, right? So this is a fibrovascular connective tissue. It's loose collagenous stroma, and here you see many multinucleated giant cells. There are abundant small vessels, and sometimes a particular thing that you see is, if this is the blood vessel, around the blood vessel you have perivascular eosinophilic cuffing, which is cuff-like deposits that surround the small blood vessels, right? So again, you have a vascular fibrous tissue with varying number of multinucleated giant cells, abundant blood vessels, and sometimes around these blood vessels you have cuff-like deposits, which is called perivascular eosinophilic cuffing. Treatment and prognosis, remember the graph, at birth it is normal, 3 years it increases, up to 5 years rapidly increases, and then begins to regress into adulthood. So the same treatment pattern follows. Okay, usually you avoid surgery unless aesthetic considerations are involved and there are severe functional problems. There are other therapies also, such as bisphosphonate therapy, but remember this point is particularly very important. Now I have some MCQs for you. Which of the following is not a feature of cherubism? Is it symmetrical swelling at the angle of mandible? Is it eyes upturned towards heaven appearance? Cervical lymph node enlargement, inverted V-shaped palate, and painful swelling behind the knee. One of these I have not talked about. The second thing is, name two histological features of cherubism. You can easily tell it by just looking at the word fibro-osseous lesion. And the third thing is, which of the following is not a fibro-osseous lesion? This one you might have to read up a bit. Make sure to answer this. Again, quickly revising, we have studied cherubism is an autosomal dominant fibrous lesion. It has spontaneous remission. Etiologically, 80% of the cases are related to SH3BPG gene mutation. Then progression of the disease increases up to 5 years and then decreases into puberty and begins to regress. Clinical features, there are three main things, which is bilateral swelling, then you have cervical enlargement, and third is eyes up. Heaven appearance. Grading, there are three grades based on involvement of ramus, tuberosity, and the entire maxilla and mandible. Radiographically, two main things. It is a multilocular cystic expansile radiolucency. The second thing is floating tooth syndrome. Histopathologically, it was a fibrovascular connective tissue lesion with multinucleated giant cells. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope it helped you in some way. And if it did, make sure to give it a thumbs up, comment, and comment the answers. And I hope to see you in another video soon. If you have any other queries or any other topics that you want covered, do let me know. Till then, have a great day and see you.